This evening on The Rock Newman Show, a look at the opioid crisis that is sweeping across the Washington, D.C. area and the nation. How has the problem reached epidemic levels, and what is the government doing to stop it? Find out right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Let's watch Washington, D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser at a recent press conference discussing the current opioid crisis in America.
Let me talk about something that is very unfortunate for us in the district in many cities, suburbs, and rural areas across the United States of America, and that is the opioid epidemic. And we have seen communities across our nation visited by unfortunate opioid addiction and fatalities related to opioid use. So it's important for all of us to remember that opioid use and death can happen to anyone, a teenager, a citizen, a senior citizen, a student, a professional, anybody. It crosses socioeconomic lines and knows no racial or religious boundaries. It breaks up families of all kinds, and it is destroying promising futures around our nation. And that's why we must work together to curb this growing problem.
We'll dive further into this topic with Oval Miller, CEO of the Black Alcohol Drug Service Information Center, Dr. Earl Etienne, assistant professor at the Howard University College of Pharmacy, and Dr. Roger Mitchell, Washington, D.C. Chief Medical Examiner. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here today. Man, if I have to say so myself, you guys are a great panel. We have Dr. Etienne down here who is able to help us define the characteristics of some of these opioids, what's good about them, what's bad about them. Got Dr. Roger Mitchell here, D.C. Chief Medical Officer, Chief Medical Examiner, who receives many of the bodies that come in as a result of opioid and other kind of drug overdoses, to be able to describe what you see once you receive. And right here is someone that we've known for a very, very long time, Oval Miller. Oval Miller is has his program in St. Louis, Missouri. And he was invited to come here because he has had extraordinarily great results with people that we have knowledge of. It's just been your success rate has been great. Dr. Etienne, I want to come to you first. We have someone here on our production staff who has a relative. This particular relative takes 240 Percocet per month. 8 Percocet per day are prescribed to him. He gets them for free. So what I want to do here is I want to talk about Percocet in a narrow sense, and then we'll broaden the conversation. But someone taking that amount of Percocet per month, who has been taking it now for years, what is that Percocet doing? What are its characteristics that make it either valuable or dangerous for this individual that's taking it?
Well, I would think that you would have to ask, what is the person taking the Percocet for? Obviously, pain. Percocet is prescribed for pain. So if he has chronic pain, Yes, that's the one of the products that one can use. Percocet is oxycodone and acetaminophen, which is basic Tylenol combined. So 5 milligrams of oxycodone with 325 milligrams of Tylenol. In some cases, you have 500 milligrams of Tylenol. So if this person has chronic pain and this is the only product that can work for them, then, you know, we'll have to ask the physician what his thinking is in terms of this high of a dose. The question that comes to my mind would be, why have they been maintained on such a high dose for as long as they have? Have there been any other interventions taken to try to wean them off of a Percocet and get them onto something that's less addictive, something like ibuprofen? So, you know, there are a number of questions that we can't just, you know, answer.
And a question I would have that perhaps we'll come back to, but a question I would have is whether or not the lobbyists for the folks that produce Percocet, what is their relationship to government? And is that sort of a microcosm of a much bigger problem in this country? I will come to you, Oval Miller, and ask you if you have thoughts about that as a drug treatment facilitator.
Well, of course, one of the things that happens is, and like you all were just discussing there, the body has a tolerance level. You know, he didn't start out doing 8 a day. He started out doing maybe 2 or 3 a day, and it keeps building and building and building. We've had people on Percocets or Valium or OxyContin taking 15 to 20, 80 milligram OxyContin. That's unheard of. But as your body builds up and you more and more you're resistant to the pain, my biggest concern is what type of pain management efforts were made, taking them off the drug and send them to a pain management center where we can start working on counseling. Right now, the government is pushing us away from counseling. It just wants to medicate. They just want to medicate, dose the clients when they come in without doing a proper assessment, you know, without proper gnosis information, you're not going to have a good diagnosis. Mm-hmm. And so this is our biggest concern, a quick fix. And because of, the interest now of more and more young Caucasians coming in, now the quick fix has got to be medication first.
I absolutely want to get back.
Okay.
I want to get back to that.
All right.
I want to really open and unwrap that aspect that you feel as if the government is strongly suggesting or insisting that there is medication before any other kind of diagnosis or treatment. I want to come back to that.
Medication first.
Dr. Miller, as the person there, as the chief of medical examiner in the morgue, you see people coming in as a result of what is now referred to as the opioid crisis.
That's right.
What do you see as a medical examiner doing autopsies that the opioids that of which we refer, it have, what kind of effect is that having on the body? And are you able to determine whether or not there is mental and psychological trauma as a result of the opioids?
Well, Rock, that's a great question. I mean, as the medical examiner here in D.C., we see the opioid deaths. What's most important is how the opioids work, right? We kind of got into that. It works on the mu receptors. These are the opioid receptors. These mu receptors, MU receptors, they're in the pain sensory locations, but they're also in the brain stem that controls our breathing, right? Mm-hmm. And so what happens with opiates or heroin or Percocet, they bind to these respiratory centers, these breathing centers, and tell the body, hey, guess what? You have too much oxygen. You need to slow your breathing down and get more carbon dioxide in your body. You need to go to sleep. So a lot of us know that deal with chronic heroin users or those that are on opiates, they're sleepy, they're leaning. They call it the lean, right?
Absolutely.
You've seen that before,
absolutely.
Right? Where
absolutely.
They're leaning because they're sleeping, their breaths contract, and what happens is they sleep and then they die. So at autopsy, what I'm seeing is, at autopsy, I'm seeing congested lungs, I'm seeing a bladder full of urine, and so those are some of the soft signs. Mm-hmm. Obviously, a lot of the users that we see are heroin users. They're going to have track marks. They're going to have other stigmata.
Yeah.
As far as their mental health, We know that there's social determinants. We were talking a little bit earlier about the social constructs that lead to our community using. Well, there's a myriad of social issues. There's a myriad of mental health issues that might lead someone to self-medicate.
Now, he talked about social issues. Your program, Unapologetically in St. Louis, you practice a modality that says that you treat from a modality point of view that is, you say, culturally specific. Culturally specific. Not just physiological, medicinal, or the other, but culturally specific. So tell us why you've gone that route. I think that many people would think if you're a drug addict, it doesn't matter if you're black, white, Chinese, Hispanic, or otherwise. You treat culturally specific. Please elaborate.
Well, one of the things is this. Treatment is based on white middle-class American males. It's not based on anybody else.
Say that again?
White middle-class American male. Treatment.
Treatment. Okay.
Substance abuse treatment. And so all the people, all of us go to school, we get our letters behind our name and all of that, but we're still based on white middle-class American males. In 1983, I got a chance to go travel to Minnesota and work with a guy by the name of Peter Bell at the Minnesota Institute on Black Chemical Abuse. That's when I learned about cultural defense mechanism, cultural survival skills, areas of emotional pain, black double consciousness, cultural schizophrenia, survival fatigue, all those issues that are not being addressed in the John Q. Everyday traditional model of treatment. BASIC has been successful because we keep our fingers on the pulse of the community. That there could be, in a block of 10 blocks square, there could be seven different cultures in that block. Culture meaning those types of behavior and problem-solving techniques exhibited by a certain group of people, ways of worship, ways of burying dead, rites of passage, can be used as a measurement to define one's culture. Counseling treatment is any type of ethical activity engaged upon by the therapist, by the counselor, that will bring about a change in behavior to the resolution of the problem. You can't do one if you don't know the other. It's impossible. So that's why we stuck to it, and that's why we've been successful with it, because even gender specificity, there's different treatment for women. It's not the same as, but for years, it's all been about men, white, middle-class American male men. And so we've broken away from that, and that's why our success
Let's stay with that for a second. Might you have an example of what you're talking about?
Sure, as far as when the cultural, the culture. See, one thing is you got people in the JVL. I'll use that for St. Louis. Now I'm not degrading JVL, but it's a
What's
area.
What's JVL?
Jeff Vanderloo Community.
Okay.
The Jeff Vanderloo Community has got 1,500 families in there. Average family size of four, a mother and three children. Average income $11,000 a year. Now, that means there are three times as many liquor stores in that community, five times more advertisement, one out of two homicides, alcohol or drug related, eight out of 10 felonies where weapons involved, alcohol or drug related. That the guy who comes out of that is evolved from the fringes of American society. Once we get through treating him, he got to go back to that. So you have to give him the tools necessary for him to go back into that community and maintain his abstinence and his self-esteem and self-worth. So each individual that comes through, an in-depth assessment has to be taken. But now the government is pushing us now to say, no, no, no assessment. When they come in, if they're on heroin, dose them. Dose them. Well, what about the diagnosis? Rock, you got a guy comes in and tells you that I'm doing $100 a day worth of dope, $150 a day. If you're not aware of what's going on in the community, you'll accept that and regulate his dosage to $150 a day. He might be a $5 a day junkie, a $10 a day junkie. If you don't know the questions to ask, well, how do you get this kind of money? Are you till-tapping, short-changing, what long-con, short-con? What are you doing? We train our staff to know the language that's being talked about. What Doc was saying a few minutes ago, the MU and the receptors and all, well, it's good for me because I write the grants. But for my counselors, talking with that guy who came off the street this morning, he wants to know about, man, can I get some Suboxone? And the Suboxone he's getting is to curb the physical withdrawal. There are two types of withdrawal, physical and psychological. We have to determine, is the psychological more driving more, or is it the physical? And I'll tell you, in a lot of instances, it's the psychological. Because once you get a man off the drug, you got to deal with the craving.
Okay. That brings me to you, Dr. Itzy. Let me, can you share with me and the audience here, when one says withdrawal, describe withdrawal.
Well, when a person is taking an opioid, they get euphoria. When they can no longer get that euphoria, they have tremors, they sweat, they just feel terrible. And that those are the symptoms of withdrawal. The Suboxone that he's talking about prevents that withdrawal from happening. It's an agonist-antagonist drug. So it puts the patient in a more settled, relaxed state, okay? So it allows you to actually deal with some of the other things associated with the addiction. Now, when we speak of the total patient, we speak of the total process. It's not just treatment in terms of drugs. We have to consider the complete patient. We have to consider the social aspects of it. We have to consider the psychological aspects. We can pull a person off the street, get them on MAT, which is medication-assisted treatment, and in some cases, because some of these individuals are the way they are, they may be on medication-assisted treatment for a long time. But if you don't add the psychological piece of that, they will never get off, okay? In some cases, you have individuals who are just like any other chronic condition, like a diabetic. They're gonna take pills for the rest of their life, okay? Now,
can I stop you there and ask you this question then? Would that then, should I surmise that you would support his treatment modality in terms of treating from a culturally specific point of view?
I will support that approach, absolutely. Because, you know, the one thing that we have today is precision medicine, okay? So we may dose individuals based on genes, right? We have that technology now. Let me give you an example. We were working with some patients, and the good doc here is aware of that activity. We were working with some patients, and the physician that we were working with found that, you know, there's something wrong here. The Suboxone was being dosed at the maximum level, but the patient was still showing withdrawal symptoms. So we know, hey, look, there must be something going on there with that patient. That physician partnered with us at the College of Pharmacy, and we did a pharmacogenomic test, right? And we found from that from that patient that they presented with a polymorphism, on which is basically a change in the gene pattern. On the gene that metabolizes Suboxone. So those in that particular patient became what we call an ultra metabolizer with that polymorphism, meaning they blow through the drug much faster than normal. So when the physician was presenting the dose based on the FDA guidelines, the patient wasn't having any relief. When we did the test and we saw that, hey, this patient is an ultra metabolizer, and the physician was able to increase the dose. Okay, that patient eliminated the symptoms of withdrawal. But again, that is outside of the FDA guidelines. So now you have to consider the whole process here. Because if you have a PBM or you have an insurance company that says, I'm only going to pay for the maximum dose approved by the FDA, but the physician is seeing a different clinical presentation, the physician really should have the ability to treat that patient appropriately based on clinical presentation. Sometimes that is very difficult.
They're not responding to it. Some of the physicians in the Midwest, Rock, we can't get them on board because they don't want to participate in medicating first. They feel like we're using a drug to get me off of a drug, and you're signing this drug. Because right now, the physicians in the Midwest have to go through an 8-hour training session to get a waiver so they can prescribe that medication.
Well, Dr. Mitchell.
Yeah, so what you're hearing here, Rock, is cultural competency from the psychological, from the social construct, and cultural competency in the science and the treatment of our people, right? So you're talking about really debunking this myth that there is a cookie cutter approach to treating substance use disorder in this country. We can't, as a community, take this cookie cutter approach anymore. One of the big things that I want to point out is this national conversation about who this user is, right? This user in the national conversation is the middle-aged white man or woman who started on opiates because they started with prescription drugs and then escalated to heroin and now are using heroin, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But that's 80% of the population. Here in DC, we are the 20%, which is our 80%. This is the 50 to 60 year old black man who's been using for 30 years, who now is dying from heroin overdose cut with fentanyl. And fentanyl is the big drug that is about 100 to 1,000 times more potent than heroin. And then there's this other drug called carfentanil.
And this is being imported from China, fentanyl?
That is correct. And it's laced our heroin, or it's replacing our heroin.
You know,
and that's what we're finding in the
part bodies. Of what I want to do as a D.C.-based show, and you being the D.C.-based medical examiner, was indeed to ask you, opioid crisis, who is coming, who's coming to the morgue?
Absolutely, absolutely. So let me back up. In 2014, right?
In what, 2014?
2014, we had about 83 opiate overdoses, right? And so that 83 opiate overdoses were from primarily heroin, right?
Okay.
In 2016, we have 213 opiate overdoses. 70%, close to 70% of those opiate overdoses are heroin with fentanyl or have fentanyl on board. What does it look like? It is the black man or woman, middle age, about 50s, 40s to 60 years old in the District of Columbia. They've been using for 30 years. And they know how to use their heroin.
They're
functional, they're handling, their Uncle Joe, they're doing what they need to do. But now this fentanyl is hitting the market in their heroin, and you can't dose that. You can't dose it the same way you dosed the heroin from the past, and they're dying at a higher rate.
And
that's
more
our epidemic.
That
they're dying, let me put it in perspective. Most of our heroin users in the District of Columbia are syringe users. There are some snorters of the heroin, but most of them are still mainlining,
Back mainlining, shooting in the vein.
Shooting IV. In the vein, IV, right? In the past, people would have time to mainline, take their syringe, take their tourniquet, put away their kit, the works, put it away, sit in the chair, and go ahead and nod out, right? Now, we're finding the syringe in the arm. They're dying at the end of the plunger.
Oh my goodness,
they don't even have time to get the syringe out and change and create
but
that environment.
I want to ask you, Oval Miller, because before you became one of the foremost practitioners, you, as I've heard you say, was a heroin addict.
Recovering junkie.
You were a junkie.
That's right.
He just talked about putting the needle in, taking it out, unwrapping it.
The ritual.
That's right, that particular ritual. But, and he said, and then sit in the chair and nod. Part of what I'd like for you to do is to reflect. During those times when you were under the scourge of heroin, what that nod felt like?
Well, think about it. I was pulling dynamite back and forth cross country in an 18-wheeler.
You were a truck driver.
I was a road driver.
So,
you know, this all comes out. This is where we can dialogue real about the social part of it. I was not raised to be a heroin addict. You know, I went through some losses, personal losses. And so you're dealing with abandonment, rejection, abuse, and grief loss issues. And not having a strong spiritual base, I didn't have anything to fall back on. So I'm out there in the street, and I'm throwing everything to win. And so I was going. The nodding that he's talking about is the point where you no longer feel. Now, Doc just mentioned something a few minutes ago. He used the word euphoria.
Yeah.
I don't use that term in my center because it's not euphoria. It is a feeling of, it's where you reach the stage where you're numbed out, Rock, where you don't feel no pain, no nothing. And they say, well, he got high, but he's really not high. He's just not feeling any pain. The average guy that overdoses in the city does not want to be brought back. The average guy that overdoses.
Let me do something. Let me stay with you for a moment as I was talking about you defining that nod.
Right.
I heard you say you were taking dynamite.
Oh yeah, pulling dynamite, ammunition.
Was part of your using steeling you against, numbing you against the possibility of what could happen with you carrying that 18-wheel truck
Oh, yeah.
of dynamite?
Or else dealing with the people in that environment. too. Mm-hmm. You know, we're pulling dynamite, we're pulling explosive, but you know, you're also dealing with people when you got copper, load of copper, and you set somebody up to get robbed or burglarized. It was on another level until it reached the point that I was homeless. So
and so what I'm trying to understand,
desperate people do desperate things.
Yes. And what I'm trying to understand is, what was it about that feeling that caused you to put everything at risk and keep chasing that feeling?
The pain is so great of the feeling of loss or feelings of rejection, individually and collectively, that nothing else seems like it mattered. And it doesn't happen all at once.
Yeah.
It progressively gets worse and worse. And as you continue going down that road, you need more and more drugs to calm, for you to numb those feelings out.
Mm-hmm.
So a guy started out at $20 a day, two buttons a day. Mm-hmm. And for us in the field, we must know what a button really is, you know, how much that you're talking about. Because my habit was up to $150 a day. That's $150 a day, 7 days a week. And the only interruption.
30 plus years.
And the only interruption that you had was if you went to jail or something happened to you. But even there, I never vied for the methadone because methadone was a life of the living dead. Now, I know some people who swear on methadone. I got a couple that was in my office 2 months ago. They were spending $196 a month on methadone every month, and the mother was paying it. I believe a human being on a drug, and tell that human being, you know, and I know my wife won't mind saying, my wife is a diabetic. Yeah. Every morning she wakes up, she takes 10 or 12 pills. Yeah. Those pills are so controlling to her that we can't go on a vacation unless she gets the pill back. Yeah. We can't go anywhere unless she gets, now she needs that.
Yeah.
Now to put someone on it, in my opinion, to say that you got induction, then you got stabilization dosage, and then you got maintenance dosage. Maintenance dosage is from now on. Mm-hmm. So if you could be up to 80, 90 milligrams a day, every day you got to go there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something, and you know, we haven't had any longitudinal studies to find out what's the effect gonna be on these guys down the line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, are they gonna come up with all sorts of issues they're dealing with? Well, like Dr. Heath did at Tulane University in New Orleans. When he was testing LSD on the prisoners, and said that it was cheaper to find black people than it was to find cats.
Yeah, Dr. Etienne, let me ask you, as someone who has represented the pharmaceutical industry, what's your take on what he just described as, you know, when the medicine, when you first come in, you have something to start to stop the craving, and then you have some maintenance, and then you,
it was induction, stabilization, and maintenance.
And
three stages.
And maintenance sounds to me like forever.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, look, there are people who are going to have to be maintained, okay, and we can't lose sight of that. But the holistic approach to treating those patients is that's what's important.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if that person is not gonna get the buprenorphine at this point, they could be, you know, in his place,
right.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
He could be cutting them to see why it is they died,
yeah.
Right? So we have to get them on treatment first and foremost, but what often happens is that we do not follow through on the process. There is not the psychiatric piece that goes with it. We don't have the wraparound services necessary to take that person from getting medication to getting the psychological help that's necessary, whether it's happening at the psychologist's office.
Mm-hmm.
What are the services in the community that will continue to keep them in line?
Mm-hmm.
You know, man has a natural desire to alter consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when that individual starts taking the drug, he's always going to be looking to feel good. Can he feel good by being part of his sports activity in his community?
Right.
We have some European studies that show where when you move the individuals from some of the rough regular activity associated with drugs, and you replace that activity with sports, right, in a massive way, it showed a phenomenal decrease in the amount of individuals who become addicted to opioids and other drugs. Mm-hmm. So we got to replace that here and think of the whole individual rather than just thinking of the drug.
Let me ask Doc one question. If you look at, I serve on the minority mental health board that meets here on the board. Now, one thing is this. I don't necessarily believe in the mental health diagnosis that comes out of our system because it's based on white middle-class American males. If you look at any mental health, especially like in St. Louis with Washington University, mm-hmm. Jewish Barnes, those large research centers, mm-hmm. if you go up there, the people who are asking the questions can't speak English. Mm-hmm. The people who are asking the questions have no knowledge of the cultural context in which the misuse or abuse developed. So how can they come up with an accurate diagnosis?
That's why you bring them to Howard.
That's right, but you're right. But if you look at schizophrenia, majority mm-hmm. of the people that we see paranoid schizophrenia. That's the thing mm-hmm. that comes down. Mm-hmm. African Americans suffer from schizophrenia the whole time. We have bicultural people, not grounded in the white world nor the black world. So we constantly are affected by cultural schizophrenia, black mm-hmm. double consciousness. Mm-hmm. So if I don't see that on a diagnosis, then I'm not willing to put a lot of stock in their interpretation that this person is having some serious mental health issues. He lives in an environment mm-hmm. where there's anger and madness constantly, day in and day out.
Dr. Mitchell, you're obviously part of DC government.
Yeah.
What is local and national government's role? Mm. What should they be doing differently?
So, that's a great question. So, man, there's a lot being said surrounding cultural competency. One of the things that I think is important to talk about, Rock, here, when we're talking about government, is really supporting these social constructs that help support individuals that want to be clean, right?
Mm-hmm.
That
such as
education, economics, housing, mm-hmm. Health care, mm-hmm. And non-disparate criminal justice and environmental justice policy, right? Mm-hmm. So government is a policy organization through our legislature and or is a programmatic delivery system mm-hmm. If you believe in the ability for government to provide actual services. So mm-hmm. our Department of Behavioral Health provides substance abuse services and then also provides contracting and or government grants for organizations, community-based organizations mm-hmm. like being discussed here by Oval. To provide direct services. Department of Health also provides grant services, no direct care, but also has federally qualified health care institutions that are providing care to our community. Mm-hmm. But the medical care that is maybe government subsidized right. Cannot just be medicine, right? You're mm-hmm. hearing it here mm-hmm. from really the same voice, yeah. two different perspectives.
Mm, sure.
It cannot just be Suboxone, yeah, which is right. buprenorphine, right. or methadone. Mm-hmm. You have to provide a environment mm-hmm. for that patient to mm-hmm. become stable.
Mm-hmm.
One of the narratives that we
defined
have to-
Defined as holistic.
Defined as holistic. Yes. It has to be holistic.
Mm-hmm. And we call it peer aftercare support.
And that's a part of it, right? Mm-hmm. So having peers that have been through it, mm-hmm. that can help you, can keep you accountable. My father was a crack cocaine addicted from the 80s all my childhood.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And
wow.
came up through abstinence, mm-hmm. right? So mm-hmm. cocaine. So yeah. his way of getting over it was abstinence, peer review, faith, mm-hmm. uh-huh. things like that, mm-hmm. right? And that's mainstay in our community.
Right.
But one of the things that we're becoming smarter about is the chronic disease component of substance use, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so when we talk about maintenance, I don't want your viewers, from my perspective,
sure.
to look at your show and say, man, I need methadone, is something wrong with me?
Yeah.
I need to be maintained on Suboxone, but before I had Suboxone, before I had methadone and all of the culturally competent services and my mm-hmm. peer mm-hmm. that was helping, before I had all that, mm-hmm. I couldn't keep a job.
Mm-hmm.
But now my family has brought me back, mm-hmm. but I still am on Suboxone mm-hmm. or methadone. I don't want people to feel as though they're not complete.
Right.
Because chronic disease, that the point that was made, similar to diabetes, mm-hmm. may be a point which you have to stay on the
mm-hmm.
insulin,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
You may have to be on the insulin.
Mm-hmm.
You've gotten to the point where all of the pancreas is burned out,
yeah.
in diabetic metaphor, mm-hmm.
right.
that you need the insulin to be healthy. So yeah. I want to, you know, there is going to be patient-centered approach. Mm-hmm. I don't think anybody here is talking about a one-size-fits-all mm-hmm. approach,
right.
But the patient, it has to be holistic, and it has to be a patient-directed approach.
I cannot do this show mm-hmm. and not address something mm. that is certainly an undercurrent in the African-American community, and it is emerging beyond being an undercurrent, being overt.
Right.
Saying that now that the majority of these
there
deaths across the country are with the from the Caucasian
there
community in the suburbs, that there is a national crisis
right.
and people are attempting to treat it from a sickness point of view, when blacks were dying on the streets, crack cocaine
yeah.
and heroin, and it was treated as from a criminal
that's exactly right.
point of view.
That's right. Exactly right. And you are so absolutely right, because I've been on the front line with this. When you started to see white children found in cars down in the inner yeah. city in the ghetto, young white children dying. Now, we got to stay on track. White children were dying back in the 80s. Because
okay.
they were the only one could go to these private treatment centers, you know, like I don't know which one's here, but we used to call them the Palace on Ballast, the Highland Hiltons, $25,000 per episode of treatment.
Mm-hmm.
But they were dying then, and they were dying on opiate drugs, Demerol, Dilaudid, these different types of opiate drugs, they were Valiums.
Mm-hmm.
And they were detoxing the people off the same drug to get them down, but they weren't talking about putting them on the Suboxone, this medication-assisted
mm-hmm.
treatment.
Mm-hmm.
So every time we look, there's a change come, but when black people were involved with it, and I went to a meeting and they got very angry with me about this, I said, well, why are we here? They said, well, Oval, you know that white children are dying for heroin use. I said, but I've been fighting heroin use for 30 years. You never come to my assistance like this. But now they're pulling out all the stops.
Mm-hmm.
Go back, Rock, to 1981, Iran-Contra scandal, when they brought the drugs and guns into our community.
Mm-hmm.
Go back and see how this is chickens coming home to roost. They never thought that the drugs would be back in their community, in their bedrooms, in
mm-hmm.
their kitchens.
Mm-hmm.
And the families are screaming. Every time I go to a meeting, the first thing they want to qualify, Oval, this is not just about white children dying.
Yeah.
But that's all it's about. Because they sent our people to the penitentiary.
Mm-hmm.
And now they don't use the same.
Now when you said 1981.
Yes.
And of course, that's when Reagan was in.
That's it. And he was one.
And the just say no.
Just say no.
The popular refrain was just say no.
His wife was going around marketing just say no, and his administration was flooding the black community and the Hispanic community with drugs. People were dying every day. Now, white children are dying. And they're robbing their grandmothers, and they're robbing their aunts. And they're leaving their kids in the cars by themselves while they go into a store and rob and steal. The same behavior that they attributed to African Americans,
mm-hmm.
that it was beast, that we were the worst people in the world,
yeah.
but desperate people do desperate things.
Mm-hmm.
And these children are suffering from the same thing, a hopelessness.
Yeah.
You got a pharmaceutical industry sending 4 million drugs into a West Virginia town that's only 400 people.
Yeah.
How do you justify that? You got doctors sitting, they don't want to be what they call prescribers,
mm-hmm.
because all he's saying is, well, send your guy over to me and I'm gonna hit him with 30 milligrams of Suboxone and let him go. But the Vivitrol, they don't want to give it. The Vivitrol is expensive. It's $1,000 a shot.
Yeah.
Vivitrol is $1,000 a shot, but once a month. Am I right, Doc? You do it once a month,
yeah.
and it's $900 to $1,000. Who can afford that on the street?
Yeah.
So you got to be involved with a program that tells you now, you can get this shot as long as you involve here in the program and be a part of the dosing factory.
Okay, let me ask this here. So, a grandson or granddaughter
mm-hmm.
who grows up, and the greatest love that they have is for that grandma
mm-hmm.
that loves them,
mm-hmm.
nourished them, has taken care of them, and give them love, maybe beyond a parent, because
right.
you know, grandparents, that's grandkids right. like the greatest.
That's right.
But there's something about these drugs and the need to have them that will compel that granddaughter or grandson to steal from that precious grandma. What is that?
So we now know that chronic substance use changes the brain's chemistry. It changes how the brain thinks. It changes frontal lobe comprehensive. It changes us, right? And so no one wants to be a drug user.
That's right.
No one.
That's exactly right.
No one.
And I've never met anyone.
You know, so when it changes who you are, it's going to change your perception of the people around you as well. Yeah. So it becomes the most important thing becomes self-preservation, and in that self-preservation becomes the access to drugs. I want to go back to the piece that you talked about, a race. Mm-hmm. Let me be clear. We know that institutional racism exists and is pervasive and has historical context in this country. But back when and still now, African American communities are being ravaged by drug abuse and violence. Those things were and are today public health issues. Mm-hmm. No matter how the system wanted to approach it. Mm-hmm. The truth is, mm-hmm. they were health issues then.
It was what it was. It was what it is.
And what annoys us is that we knew it then, and now the larger community is calling the truth now. Mm-hmm. What I don't want us to miss in our wanting to call out institutional racism, which we've called it, to miss an opportunity to ensure that the resources that are being established now for this health crisis, that our communities don't miss the opportunity. Right. Mm-hmm. Because right now, still the funding is evading. The great thing about being a DC resident, because I'm a DC resident, and working for DC, is that we have been working on this problem even before it's been called.
The crisis.
Mm-hmm. We've been looking at this opioid issue and trying to do our wraparound and trying to bring waivers in for Suboxone even before it's been called a crisis, largely because of how our government is set up and who we are in this city. Mm-hmm. But a lot of cities where it's concentrated African Americans or Latinos or poor whites don't have that. And so it's being seen through the lens of the larger state.
Yeah.
The larger state is largely rural.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so it's 80% the problem and 20%.
You say they don't have that, and this administration that's in right now seems to take they gave some lip service to it being a national crisis. Yeah. But in terms of what's is needed,
there's no funding.
I need to ask Dr. Etienne a question.
No funding.
Again, and you know, pardon me for saying, you know, I don't mean you represent the pharmaceutical industry.
I'm a pharmacist.
Oh, so you're a pharmacist.
I will accept.
So what part profession? Of what is happening now is the pharmaceutical industry has become a boogeyman.
Yeah, it sure has.
And some say it's well-deserved. Mm-hmm. And boogeyman in the sense that its objective seems more to be profit than it is to help fix problems. Mm-hmm. So, speak to that, please.
It's a business. A pharmaceutical company's main objective is to maximize shareholder wealth, and they will do what is necessary to maximize shareholder wealth. If maximizing shareholder wealth means improving conditions of patients, then they will spend time improving conditions of patients as well. Okay? We have to accept what is and make adjustments in the way we attack those systems to ensure we get from it what we need to get from it. Okay, we have grown up in the society to be a pill popping society. Let's pop a pill and fix the problem. Rather than looking holistically at where things are happening. You know, many of these issues that we're talking about, very few people talk about the faith-based component of it. Okay, but we've seen that when you deal holistically and you have individuals going in a different direction, that process helps. Yeah. It helps them as well. But so we need to look comprehensively at the problem. Mm. Pharmaceutical companies are businesses. Yeah. They're going to make profits at whatever way they can. But we have regulatory agencies. The FDA has done a tremendous job in terms of trying to deal with those issues. You have the attorneys who have jumped on the bandwagon, just like they did with tobacco. The companies that have made these products and know that you were distributing products into communities in large quantities and they don't have the numbers of people, mm-hmm. then hold them accountable. Mm-hmm. You know, I am all for accountability. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you do the crime, you know, you do the time. Right. Yeah. But we need to be real. Yeah. I say let's shift the construct somewhat, uh-huh. okay? We are now having a renewed attention to addiction as a disease. It's right. no longer criminalized,
right.
okay?
Right.
This is an opportunity for
That's
us,
right. uh-huh.
okay? We need to say, hey, listen, wonderful. I understand what happened in the past, but yeah. let me help you atone for what you did in the past by jailing all my young black brothers and sisters, uh-huh. by saying, hey, those individuals who are returning to the community, yeah. let's ensure we have wraparound services for them and we build up the community. Let's move jobs into that community and say, hey, listen, these individuals can indeed work. Let's do the things necessary to make them whole again
yeah.
and make them truly contribute to society. And in that way, you know, you'll have a much better
outcome. We sit here tonight and are doing this show. Uh-huh. Tomorrow on the campus of Howard University, you've been very much a part of initiating and coordinating a comprehensive
yes.
initiative and then symposium. What are your objectives for that symposium?
We are hoping to bring the best and brightest minds together to inform our student and faculty population, because we believe firmly that we are creating the next leaders to deal with this crisis, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. We are addressing in the symposium from a legislative perspective. So we want to see what state and federal legislature has to do, what has worked, what hasn't worked, what's the action plan to make things different. We're looking at the regulatory and research bodies like NIH, FDA, and seeing, hey, you know, do you have the resources necessary? What's the research in the pipeline that can assist us in terms of taking steps? We look at the treatment community. We bring people from the community, physicians, pharmacists, social workers, all of those individuals coming together to say, hey, listen, this works, this doesn't work. How do we create an action plan to go ahead and fix it? Mm-hmm. Then we look at innovation and enforcement. You know, we have a judge on the panels.
Yeah.
What are you doing in terms of, do you think we should lock people up or we should move them into treatment? Where does the legislative piece connect with the regulatory and the enforcement piece? And then lastly, we have the faith-based community. We have folks from the Christian community. We have folks from we have an imam, the Imam of Washington. We have a rabbi on the program. Mm-hmm. And we are gonna talk holistically about how we take a patient through this construct. Mm-hmm. And by the way, one thing is important. You know, at the end of the day, we talk about economics. The one thing that we always miss is the economics of the situation. Mm-hmm. And there is money to be made in the process. If yeah. we're gonna treat our people yeah. and it costs,
yeah.
right,
yeah.
then we should set up the construct so that the individuals within the community have the opportunity to participate in those things as well.
Mm-hmm. So I learned something from you that was somewhat alarming. Mm. As much as we know what Dr. Etienne just said, that pharmacy is the business. That was his very mm-hmm. first response, very transparent, very honest answer. Mm-hmm. And we know that, and it's still startling to hear it because we know part of what happens there is oftentimes business puts profit over people.
Yeah.
I want to ask you, did I hear you correctly when you said that you are being dictated to by the state of St. Louis,
yeah.
where from which you get some of your
yeah, right,
funding,
right,
that you must give medicine before diagnosis even?
That, Rock, this is unbelievable. It's called state targeted response, STR. I don't know if you all are familiar with that up here. Yeah. The state targeted response. And what the state is saying is that all programs, outpatient or inpatient programs, that when a patient comes in, before you go any further than getting his name, if they say they're opiate, you put them in your STR program, which means that they're dosed. Mm. Now, there's several dosing centers around the city. This is why I'm so adamant.
Dosed giving medicine.
That's right. I'm so adamant about this because there's several dosing centers around the city where if you can go by to any given day and you'll find two or three white vans pulling up, 15-passenger vans with African-Americans and sprinkling of whites getting out, going into this center and being dosed.
Mm.
They don't want to, they play it down, but it's, that's what you're seeing, mm-hmm. without any efforts to find out what's going to be the end result later on down the line. Mm-hmm. Now, they are saying to us is that they want us to get our clients, what Doc is saying, get them stable so they don't have to go through the craving, the physiological craving. Now, I'm going to say this. I've never met a junkie that died from withdrawal. Mm-hmm. I never met a junkie who died from withdrawal, okay. from heroin withdrawal. Mm-hmm. Now, they would die from Dilaudid, Demerol, any of those synthetic opiates. There's a possibility, but mm-hmm. Heroin, mm-hmm. well, I used it, you see I said Heroin. Heroin, yeah. mm-hmm. I've never seen a junkie die from that. Mm-hmm. I've never had an overdose in my office in 30-some years. Never had one, and I deal with 90% of them are heroin addicts.
Okay.
Now, we monitor that because we have a relationship with the guys that say, look, man, if you done bought bunk, and I'm using street terms,
yeah.
you bought some bunk, don't come and mix it up with that fentanyl, because what you're going to do is you're going to unleash a tiger and you can't control it.
Yeah.
So there has to be an education about how to mix the drug until you get the guy ready to come off of it. I just don't believe that we reached a stage where everything has to be medically treated, medication used to control every aspect of your life. Mm-hmm. I just don't believe that. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, I know some people. When Doc mentioned about the pharmacy, it hurts to feel realize that somebody would take and put 4 million pills in a community of only 400 people. Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask how many pharmacists was in that community, and they told me it was 4 pharmacists in that community of 400 people. Right. 4 pharmacists. Yeah. Now, how? What kind of regulation that they were using to dispense it? Now, I know people went to Florida. We got guys mm-hmm. who drive to Florida and get 300 mm, pills. We got them up in Ohio, get 300 or 400 pills. They go, and the best place, Rock, and I know this is something we're going to bring out, is the senior citizen homes. See, this is where the drugs, where we went around that. It's where the people are in there on fixed incomes. Yeah. They're under the doctor's care. The doctor don't have any solutions for them, so they medicate them. They give them 100 pills of Percocet, 100 pills of Vicodin, 150 pills of OxyContin. And here come the guy off the street to come by. Now, OxyContin, 80 milligrams goes for $120 on the street, one pill. So if you're sitting in a senior citizen home and you got 100 pills and somebody come through and say they're going to give you $400 for your pills and you only getting $800 or $900 a month, that's sure sense revenue coming back into you. Mm. That's something that we have not addressed, mm-hmm. is that mindset and that mentality on that.
Yeah.
But we have. That's why you're seeing so much violence, Rock, in the senior citizen home, because yeah. these guys are coming through and robbing the people, taking their money, forcing them to sell those drugs or those prescriptions.
You know, we've got maybe about 3 minutes left. Mm. Before we get to the end, I want to do something what I think is a very valuable service for our viewers. Mm. And that is to be able to put up information. We have information starting with Oval Miller here as to how you might be able to be reached, and also the rest of our guests here. We can put that up. Okay. Your phone number.
Yeah, 314.
Not your cell number.
Okay, 314-621-9009.
Okay.
That's the central office in St. Louis, Missouri.
Okay. And how,
absolutely. I have a lot of good statistics on what this looks like, how it trends over the last 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. OCME.DC.gov. You can go on there. And click on the data link, and you can see all the data surrounding opiate overdoses in the district, heroin overdoses, fentanyl, mm-hmm. how it looks in the District of Columbia August of this year. Mm-hmm. And then my number is 202-698-9000. Mm-hmm. 202-698-9000.
Is the symposium open to the public tomorrow?
The symposium is open to the public.
And where is
we are asking you to register. However, there's a link. It's online. It's at Crampton Auditorium. We'll be there. Uh-huh. Continental Breakfast is at 7 o'clock. We start promptly at 8, and we run till 4. So it is open to the public. My contact information, I'm here at Howard University College of Pharmacy. Mm. My office number is 202-806-4209, and I'm certainly available. You know, if there is if there are questions, my email address is earl.etienne, E-T-T-I-E-N-N-E, yeah, at howard.edu. Yeah.
And after 30 plus years of Oval successfully treating people, and part of the reason I was so adamant about him trying to get here is because there are people very, very close to me that have gone to his program. They have been, the proper description, junkie, down and out and hitting their bottom. Mm-hmm. And the success rate with those individuals is 100%. Yeah. They've come back and been extraordinarily great citizens, better in their lives even than they were before. Yeah. And I don't know a better testament to give to a center that treats drug and alcohol. To each of you, man, this hour has gone by just too fast. Thank you so much, because each of you have something that is valuable that you're contributing, and we very much appreciate you joining us today.
Thank you for giving us this audience,
for having us. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. God bless, and I'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.